Hello boys and girls, let me start this video with a math question to you. So this the green thing here is just my terminal, and I'm going to use this to hide information that I will reveal. So let's say you have some analytic function. It even works with power series, but for the sake of simplicity, let's start out with some polynomial. You have some easy polynomial here. It reads g of x equals 2 plus 0x plus 5x squared minus 6x cubed plus x to the power 4. And my question to you is, if you plug into this polynomial x squared, what will the result be? Well, you can pretty much read it off. Lowest order coefficient will still be 2. It's not affected. There's still no linear term, and this 5x to the power of 2 will become 5x to the power of 4, right? And then some higher terms. Looks like this. So this is basically just pattern matching. You can read it off. Let's say you plug in something more complicated. This here, pi times x to the power of 3. Well, you can still do the. You can still pretty much read it off, right? You can know it's 2. Plus 5 times pi to the power of 2 times 6 x to the power of 6, so blah blah blah, it will be like this thing. Okay, you can read that off. But now my question to you is, if the input to this g is another polynomial, what will the output be? Right, so I have this g, I plug in 3x minus 4x squared plus x cubed. What will be the it will be another polynomial. You can know that, okay, the lowest coefficient will still be 2. The highest coefficient, you can also read it off. You will see this is x to the power of 12, and in between there's also going to be just some monomials multiplied by some number. In this case they will all be some integers. But what integers are they? Well, if you don't have a computer algebra system or whatever, then you might have to do that by hand. Or what this video is about, there's also actually a nice formula. You can actually compute the, I don't know, you can compute the eighth order coefficient even without computing anything else. There's a direct formula for this, and that's what we are going to do in this video. Okay, so before I get into it, however, let me spend 30 seconds or so on a small update. I have not made a video in 2 months or so. The main reason being that I'm reading and coding, like I did before, a little bit in the cryptocurrency direction. But if I make videos about cryptocurrency stuff, then there's just idiots subscribing to my channel, and I want to keep it like on the mathy level. And since I'm also, I'm reading a bunch of books at the moment. One of them is Generating Functionology, which is about formal power series in combinatorics. And so I was looking a little bit more into something close to what we are doing here. And so I thought that would be a nice topic to discuss in a 30-minute video or so. Okay, so getting back to it. Well, to without spoiling you, explain the formula that does the trick, I have to talk a little bit about Bell polynomials, because they are going to be the main part of this formula, and they're pretty simple to understand, even if there's a lot of things to do with them. So these are polynomials in some finite amount of variables, so very high multivariable polynomials with some integer coefficients, and they encode information, namely they encode something about the partitions of sets. So okay, here's an example. This example is really just stolen from the Wikipedia page, but it's a good size example. So let's say you have a 6-element set, right? You have a set with some elements, there are 6 of them, and you ask how many ways are there to partition this thing into two sets, into two non-empty sets, right? And so you the obviously you can partition it into five parts and one part, so like so. And since there are six different elements, it's easy to see that there are six ways of partitioning this thing, right? And then you might ask, okay, the same set, how to partition it into two non-empty sets? So there would be this thing and more. And you can write, in this case, you can still write it down by hand and you will find there are 15 such partitions. And then the same thing for three and you will find there are 10. And the Bell polynomials with two indices, n and k, right? A set of n size cardinality and a k number of partitions exactly encodes this information in that way. And from this example, you should basically be able, let me see, yeah, you see this, you should be able to read off how that works, right? So the coefficient here is the number of possibilities, and this is a polynomial of five variables, and the indices of the variables indicate the size of the partitions. So the sum of these indices of these variables is always the cardinality of the set. So 5 plus 1 must be 6. This is just the number of partitions, and here it is 15, and 4 plus 2 is again 6, and 3 plus 3 is also 6. And I could have written 10 times x3 times x3. Okay, so this is the definition, like the combinatorical definition of the polynomials. And since, you know, if you do algebra and there's some, you know, commutative algebra and you have to collect ways of putting things together, these polynomials will just simply naturally pop up in a way. You will be able to express some stuff in terms of these polynomials by their construction. And there's a nice long-ish Wikipedia page. They explained this is the explicit formula that you will also see in a second. A little bit complicated. I will not dwell on it too much, because we are just going to use. I will, by the way, in this video also implement like a showcase that things work out, and I will use a Python library implementation of those things. So here are some examples that I stolen. And I want to emphasize that there is also, sorry for the fast scrolling, there's also the, come on. Yeah, there's also the variant of these polynomials where you sum away the k index, right? So you have all, like bn encodes all ways of partitioning an n cardinality set into non-empty partitions. So this is just integrating out the k index. As I said, I'm going to use SymPy, symbolic Python library, and there are this function called Bell, and I'm just going to use those. Okay, so with those, you can compute them explicitly, but whatever. And so the main theorem of this video is then this. Given any formal power series that that start at the linear coefficient, right? So sum over all natural numbers excluding zero, with coefficient gn, and in this case I write them with this 1 over n factorial factor. So this is the exponential representation, but of course you can also, you know, you can rename this, you can say gn times 1 over n factorial, you can call this an, and then you have the same theorem with this other representation. So that's just an implementation detail that we carry this factor along. But you have two generic form power series starting at the linear coefficient, and then if you concatenate them, you get another formal power series, another infinite series. And of course, you know, if you say after a certain n all the coefficients are zero, then you have a polynomial, right? This is where the special case of polynomials comes in. But so if you concatenate this function g of f of x, then you get obviously another one of those formal power series or power series. And the theorem is then that these coefficients are computed as such. You sum the outer coefficients, the gks, up to n, right? It makes sense that the nth coefficient cn only depends on everything up to that. And then you take this inner product basically with this gk vector, and these numbers, and these numbers are exactly the Bell polynomials where the variables used are certain fi's, so certain coefficients there, right? Yeah, okay, so that's the answer, right? Now, if I give you two formal power series and say I concatenate them with them, you can literally tell me by using this formula what the seventh coefficient is of the seventh order, without even computing anything before or after. You can just use this formula if you have a good way of computing these Bell polynomials. And you know, here we have a restriction that the f should have lowest coefficient linear. Technically, also as I stated it here with the g, right? I said it should not have a g zero coefficient, but actually it's clear that even if g zero is not zero, then you can use that, but you can say, just say g of f of x equals g0 plus, and then this expression. I want to emphasize that this formula only works with g f0, 0, and for anything else, you will have to do some more work. So that's cool. this whole topic is more prominently known in the case where g is the exponential function, and then the thing is called exponential formula. Not to be confused with just the expression for how to compute the exponential function. The exponential formula says that you have this. This power series, this was our f starting at n equal 1, and you take the exp of that. What is the result of that? Well, it's something even more simple than what we have. You know, our formula was in terms of the bn case, and here it turns out that basically the exponential function of a formal power series is the sum over these things. So there's this intricate relationship between exp and these combinatorial polynomials. And that could be not too much of a surprise. I have made videos before on the exponential function in relation to certain magical numbers in a way. You know, 1 over 12 and all this sort of rational numbers that are special. And if you know quantum field theory, this is also a lot about like doing expansions of e to the something, where the e to the something usually comes from infinitesimal translations, Lie group theory, whatever. This is just a special case. We have a more general case in this video. By the way, one place where on the internet where I also found this formula is in the Fadi-Bruno formula. So here it's also stated in a way. Although the Fadi-Bruno formula is actually this formula for the nth derivative of the concatenated function. So this is also a cool formula. So if you have f and g's and you can concatenate them and take the nth derivative, then you get this thing, which is obviously closely related. Okay, but that's another story. So in the rest of the video, I will show you an implementation that I did, like a small Python implementation that validates this claim. So This is the code. I will switch, however, to Atom, because there we have syntax highlighting. This is the same file that I just looked at, but for the Python part, it has syntax highlighting. Okay, I use just very standard libraries. I start out by showing you how the these Bell polynomials work in the SymPy library, because this is very nice. It's not Mathematica. You don't have too much symbolic manipulations, but nonetheless, if I run this and I print the here this Bell 6.2, then it actually shows me these functions in this symbolic form, which is cool. But that's just for show. These Bell NK functions is what I'm going to use. That's what I import here, and I make free use of it. Okay, and as in previous videos, I have a very functional approach to coding up my math stuff. And in particular, I try to crystallize out convenience functions so that the main code then ends up being very short. And I also use a lot of iterators again. So this code, my examples that I will show you at the end is on polynomials, the polynomial that I showed you at the beginning of this video. But it will be very easy to extend the same code to infinite former power series, for example, where it then computes stuff one after the other. Even if these Bell polynomials, at least in this Python implementation, are not computed very fastly, but whatever. Okay, so I use also the fraction library just to get more exact result, because obviously if you're dealing with polynomial with very large inputs with very high powers and you have some float computations, then you get very big errors very fast. And so to some extent I try to curb this and keep the error small by using the exact rationals library here. And for that I have here like some division function that does casting. Okay, it's not so interesting. I will not go into detail about the stream stuff, because I have several videos where I use streams in Python nicely. This is the infinite list of natural numbers, right? It starts out by zero, it yields zero, it, you know, you can pop zero, and then you can pop all other numbers forever. Then monomials, this is a, you know, given any x returns the infinite stream of x to the power of n, where n goes on forever. Like two vectors or streams, actually, v and w return the stream of all component wise multiplications, return the stream of all multiplications of this former power series and k factorial. I will need that to translate between these representations, right? If I go back, I talked about the fact that we have here this extra 1 over n factorials. This is simply the standard representation of the formula. If you look at, if you look here, then where they also state the formula, then they just use this like that. This is just a convention that is used there because it has some benefits in doing combinatorics, generating functions. The same with division. Here's a function. If you have a finite list and it pads zeros at the end, it's just some convenience function. Here's the inner product. Here is the evaluation of polynomial. So former power series. I represent the former power series by a stream of its coefficients, right? And so if you have a polynomial, then this is just a list of the coefficients of the polynomial. And so if you want to evaluate it, then what you can do is you take this list of coefficients, you take the list of the monomials at the value x, and then you do the inner product. Then you do have component-wise multiplication and sum over it, and then you get exactly the value of the polynomial. This is this neat implementation here. And then some pretty print function, which prints lists and does some rounding and so on. This is not so important. Okay, and then we are already at the implementation. I implemented here for my simplicity, to assume that the input are finite polynomials, Although we, as I said, you can extend it if you want. If you want to do that, I would be interesting. You can post in the comments if you have an extended version that works with streams, and then you might write a printing function which computes all the infinite concatenated versions. You can extend that to a stream is what I'm saying, but in this case I implemented two just pass polynomials, i.e. finite lists of coefficients. And so what I do here is I start out, I cast them to actual lists in case there are streams. I return the first value. The first value is the G0. So here I assume that there's this zeroth coefficient. And again, if you look at the formula, this is the formula. I start out by returning the first element. This is this. And then what I have to do now is compute this inner product between this. The B's here are the GK's in my notation, and the Bell polynomials, and then divide by the factorial and add these monomials. So I assume, as required in the theorem, that the zeroth coefficient of F is zero. As I deal with polynomials, I can compute upfront what the highest order will be. Right, and then you can do the math and you find out, well, it's 1 plus the highest order multiplied. And you know, I paired them with zero. So here, nothing happened except for format conversions to deal with this representation. And now the implementation. We need this sum over n. The sum over n values, so this inner sum here is this, it goes from 1 to n of these products. I see this is an inner product, so I want to have this vector of the coefficients of G and this vector of these Bells. And so the problem here is that the notation for this Wikipedia article is different than mine. I sum over n from 1 to the order that I computed up front. I computed up front how far I have to go. I don't go to infinity, I go to the order. And then I compute this inner product of this thing, right? So this is the outer index, and I return all the coefficients of the concatenated return value. I compute this Bell's vector, which has for all small index k the values, and then I do the inner product with the coefficients and these Bells. Right? I hope you see how that works out. Right? So this is Bell. This is just the input. This is just this thing with the right coefficients of the f function, and I return those. And in another step, to have the n factorial coefficients right, if I pass f and g as like a polynomial, i.e. if I pass them without these factorials, then I have to add the factorials, then use my function, and then divide out this n factorial at the end. So I have to first add them to get to this representation where they have them. Then I do the implementation of the thing that I just did, and in the end I divide out factorial again, so that just the inputs and outputs match. And this is what happens here. Right here is this Bell coefficient concatenation with extra factorials added and removed again. Okay, and that's that. Let me comment out. I have already done that. Let me comment out the pretty print. And so I will show you that things work out by doing both ways. On the one hand, I use my implementation. On the other hand, I will just use the evaluation functions. So here's my examples. This is the function that we started with, right? This is from the example. Any polynomial would do. And here is the input from the example. And GF, my girlfriend is this function that where I just use the implementation that we just did. This is just this thing. And then I get a concatenated function, and the nice thing is that it is then as a list of the coefficients. That is already done. And I can evaluate it wherever I want without having to evaluate G and F separately. So I have this small testing function here. The test takes any value at which it's going to be tested and an epsilon. And on the one hand, the left hand side is the manual twice evaluation. I take F evaluated X and the return value is passed to G. And the other way is using the GF that we just computed with the Bell formula. And then the absolute value of the difference is compared against epsilon. This is my test. And the difference should be zero. But if I use floats, then it will not be zero, just numerically. And so that's what I do here. So I set the epsilon value to zero. It must be exact. I use the exact rational numbers implementation division that I started showed you at the start. And I test this at various values. I tested it 0, 1 third, 2 thirds, 1, and so on and so forth. And I test that. And so, okay, let me move this X. So, and if I do this, so if everything works out, then he should just print the concatenated function and not complain about these tests, right? Okay, so I evaluate it here. Okay, and he didn't complain, so everything works out perfectly. You know, I can show you if I make this error bound smaller, then he will complain because the error is bigger than the epsilon. You see this? Some error here. This is the same test, but with floats, where I don't divide by 3 but by pi. So to answer the question from the start of the video, right, where I ask, hey, what will this actually be? G of f of x. We could see that it starts with 2 and it will end with x to the power of 12. And here I computed by hand what the second coefficient will be, right? 5 times 3 to the power of 2 is 45. And indeed, that's what we get here. Okay, let me just check something. Second. Oh, yeah. I just see that the function that I've chosen is a little bit shorter because the computation takes longer. I cut it. I was just confused because if you use this function x to the power of 4 and this function x to the power of 3, then the last coefficient must be 1. The last coefficient, like the last term, must be 1 times x to the power of 12. And the return value was not that, it is minus 6. And so I knew something was wrong, but so I suppose this is a test on the fly. If we plug in here a 1, so this we have the x to the power of 4 at the end, and then exit early and just print, then the last coefficient must be, the whole thing must be longer, and the last coefficient is a 1, exactly. Okay. Okay, and so that seems to work out very nicely. The tests don't fail. And as a last example, I show you here. Oh, is it still in the picture? No. I show you here. So I hope you saw that before. Maybe not. I'm sorry for that. In case I didn't show you this floating example. But so the last thing I want to show you here is taking the logarithm and the exponential function, which are inverses of each other, right? I use them to a finite approximation. I say the logarithm, so this is actually log 1 plus x, right? I should add that. This is yeah, sadly this editor will. So this is 1 plus x, and this is x of x minus 1, right? So I do that to make sure that the first coefficient is the linear one. And so the log is 0 plus x minus x squared over 2 plus x cubed over 3 and so on. This is the series expansion of the log by hand up to the fourth coefficient. And similarly, the exponential function minus 1 is x plus x squared divided by 2 factorial plus x cubed divided by 3 factorial and so on and so forth. So this is this in the rational implementation. And so if I concatenate them in both ways, then it should be something which is close to just the polynomial x, the identity function. Of course, we will have some error because these are not actually the logarithm and exponential functions. They are just a very finite approximation to them. But as you will see in a second, it looks nevertheless pretty nice. So if I execute them, I print the x block and log x, you know, this shifted exponential and shifted logarithm function. And I have to save. Okay, there's still an exit in there somewhere. And if I do that, then you will see... Jesus. Okay. Since I added the 1, the error is bigger because the numbers are higher. So this already pretty big epsilon doesn't suffice anymore. I will just remove that so that it works again. And after some waiting, we will see that the this is the x block, the x of log of 1 plus x and the whole thing minus 1 is this thing. So we can see this is more like this is a polynomial of, I don't know, 15th order or so, or it should be 16, yeah, something like that. And we see that by construction, the constant term is zero. And then indeed, this is just one times x, and then a bunch of zeros. And then in the higher order, some numerical non-zero-ness pops up because I have this just sloppy finite approximation to this transcendental functions. And so some coefficients have non-zero some monomials have a non-zero coefficient factor there, but a smaller one. And these two functions are also very similar to one another. This x block and log x concatenated in this final approximation is similar. And so basically, this is very close to just a polynomial p of x is equals x. Okay, so I hope that was of interest. I find this very interesting, not only because Bell polynomials are so close to combinatorics and hands-on, but also since concatenation is, of course, such an absolutely fundamental operation. And usually I studied physics, but in my studies, I never really had to deal with these sort of, you know, Stirling numbers and so on in much detail. I never had really a reason to learn it or remember it, but I regret it often, especially, as I said, if you read a quantum field theory paper, then some of them, especially the ones written by mathematicians, are basically combinatorics, like complicated versions of these sort of things. And the exponential function hunts you down, and that's why this is important. Okay, I don't want to chat here too much. I hope this was interesting. I'm thinking maybe I do an update video on how I've been doing in the last 3 months. I bought another book, even though my reading list is long enough. But I have here one book on the history of mechanical principles. So, you know, D'Alembert, Lagrange. But this is a history book and talks about the works of, you know, the greats, Euler and so on and so forth. And it's a fat book, very a very critical expert, 500 pages. It's pretty cool. I don't have too much time, but I really want to get into through that. I've been looking into that. Sadly, I have not really started with the drone yet. You know, if you know from my videos in Christmas, I have a drone and I wanted to do some Lagrangian mechanics drone flight videos and programming. I haven't gotten to that much. I am interested in some crypto projects. There's one called Chia. I'm mostly interested in it because it uses Python from scratch, and that's where I just can get in and toy around with it. I usually try to stay away everything JavaScript, and sadly I'm not really an expert in Rust. There's a lot of projects in that space in Rust. But okay, so due to that, as I said before, I don't really want to make really videos on blockchain stuff, because then you have blockchain in the title and then your viewer base gets tailored too much in that direction. So I hope this sort of thing that I just did was interesting to you. Write me in the comments, how do you feel about generating function and combinatorics, and whether you liked it. Write me in the comments if you made it so far in this video. Namaste, and take care.